Inside of me and my natural fitra is that there was a creator.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى أصحابه أجمعين. Today is the third day, the third day of understanding the basics of Islam and going through the book of Islamic Creed, Islamic Aqeedah by Sheikh Muhammad ibn Zino. And alhamdulillah, we've covered a lot of topics, you know, concerning the Tawheed and everything. And our topic today, mashallah, is really, really powerful. It's still intensive. So may Allah give us, you know, some patience and some power to go through it. Now, what is the ruling in Islam concerning applying non-Islamic laws? We live in the West, and there's no Islamic law here. Unfortunately, in the Muslim lands, where it's been dominated by Muslim people, they don't apply Islamic laws at the same time, unfortunately. So what is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam is saying in regards to the people, Muslim people, or people in general, they're not applying the rules of Islam? Abiding the laws which are contrary to Islam and accepting them as superior to Islamic laws is rejection of faith. Straightforward. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْكَافِرُونَ. And whoever does not judge by what Allah has revealed, these people are the kafirun, the disbelievers. And the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam said, وَمَا لَمْ تَحْكُمْ أَئِمَّتِهِمْ بِكِتَابِ اللَّهِ وَيَتَخَيَّرُ مِمَّا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ إِلَّا جَعَلَ Allahu ba'sahum baynahum. Subhanallah azza wa jal. So when the leaders do not rule by Allah's book and choose from that which Allah has rejected, Allah will cause conflict among them. What a strong hadith. Subhanallah azza wa jal. Yani what we see today, unfortunately, in our Muslim lands, do we see agreement on conflict? Straightforward agreement or straightforward conflict? Straightforward, subhanAllah. Why? Because we've lost the plot. If you see in the Islamic history, subhanAllah, when we were ruling in Spain for 800 years in Spain, the Jews and the Christians and even the non-believers, they were trying to travel all the way to the Islamic land so they can live there. Why? Because we had the best economical system, the best educational system, we had the best judgment, fairness in treatment, everything. There used to be an EDL member, yeah? He said something very interesting. He said, I studied the history of Muslims and Christians to understand what's happening in the world today in regards to politics, yeah? So he said, when I saw that the Christians left their faith and their teachings, they became to progress and they became to be more civilized. And when I saw the Muslims leaving their own teachings, they became the third world countries. Yeah? SubhanAllah Azza wa Jal. So basically we understand from this, SubhanAllah, that when we leave our teachings of Islam in regards to ruling a place or ruling a country, this is what happened between the Muslims' conflict. And this we saw, alhamdulillah, in history, and we see it till this day. Now, a very important question that comes in the head of every single person, and Allah is saying this is coming from the shaitan. He say, what if Satan tempts us with the question, who created Allah? Now, we deal with this question from the atheistic point of view on a different manner. Inshallah, when you attend the class of the dawah training next weekend, inshallah, you will understand how we can deal with it this weekend. Oh, subhanAllah, this weekend. But from an Islamic perspective, as a Muslim, yeah, what you need to know, if Satan tempts you with this question, you should seek refuge in Allah. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَإِمَّا يَنْزِغَنَّكَ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ نَزْغِ فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ إِنَّهُ هُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. And if an evil whisper from Satan tries to turn you away, Ya Rasulullah, from doing good, then seek refuge in Allah. Verily, He is the all-hearer and all-knower. So if you were thinking and saying, okay, who created Allah as a Muslim, what you should do is, you should say, A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim, and khalas, that's it. And the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam taught us to resist Satan's deceptions. He teaches us some du'as to say. For example, Amantu billahi wa rusulihi, Allahu ahadun, Allahu samad, lam yalid wa lam yulad wa lam yakun lahu kufwan ahad. It resembled the Surah Al-Ikhlas. Thumma liyadfula an yasarihi thalatha, وَلْيَسْتَعِذْ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ وَلْيَنْتَهِ فَإِنَّ ذَلَكَ يَذْهَبُ عَنْهِ. Basically, what you say is, I believe in Allah and His Messenger. He is Allah, the One. Allah, the Self-Sufficient, the Master, whom all creatures need. He neither eats nor drinks. He begets not, nor is He begotten, and there's nothing like Him. And then you spit over the left shoulder 3 times without water. Yeah? And then you seek refuge from the shaitan, from Satan. And when you do so, the temptation will pass. Now, one should say in response to this question, who created Allah? Is Allah is the creator and that He has not been created. The idea of creation itself is a logical fallacy, we call it. Yeah? To make things easier to understand, the Sheikh gave us an example. One comes before two, and nothing comes before one. Straightforward. Allah is one, and nothing comes before Him. As the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam said, Allahumma anta al-awwalu fala shay'an qablak. In Muslim, he said, Allah, you are the first, and there is nothing before you. So if they say before one there's zero, zero is nothing. Nothing. There's no atoms, there's no electrons, there's no power, energy, laws, force, there's nothing. And there is nothing, nothing comes. Straightforward. And Allah, alhamdulillah, we know that this creation has been created. We can see the design, we can see the energy, we can see a lot of things and laws. Therefore, these things don't come from nothing, even by science. They cannot disprove that. Now, what were the beliefs of the idolaters in Arabia before Islam? What did they believe in? Since we follow an Arabian prophet, we need to understand the situation of the nation that he was sent for them. They used to pray to saints to earn their pleasure. Yeah? And to intercede between their businesses. Allah said, وَالَّذِينَ اتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِهِ أَوْلِيَاءَ مَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ إِلَّا لِيُقَرِّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ زُلْفَى. And those who take awliya, protectors and helpers beside Allah, and they say, we worship them only that they may bring us near to Allah. Only that, yani, subhanAllah, this is what we worship Him for. So they can get us closer. Like an intercessor. Like Mawlana Fulan will bring me closer, or the Sahabi will bring me closer, or the Rasul will bring me closer, yeah? And what did Allah say? وَيَعْبُدُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ مَا لَا يَضُرُّهُمْ وَلَا يَنْفَعُهُمْ وَيَقُولُونَ هَؤُلَاء شُفَعَاءُنَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. Allahu Akbar. Allah is saying, and they worship besides Allah things that hurt them not, nor they profit them. And they say, these are our antecessors with Allah. Yeah? Some Muslims do that, yes or no? Different madhahab, they go and say, you know, this Mawlana. Ya Mawlana, please ask, you know, this, you are the intercessor, and they worship him. Why? Because they think this guy, on the day of judgment, can come in the day of in front of Allah and say, Ya Allah, just put him to Jannah, don't worry about it. Yeah? So we have a guideline. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, we don't do that. Why? They will never benefit you. Straightforward. Now, these topics that we're speaking about relates to the major sins that we spoke about in the last session. So how do we eliminate all traces of shirk, taking partners with Allah? Now, shirk cannot be completely eliminated unless we have to exclude the following. One, the belief that others share in Allah's works, such as Sufi madhab. They believe that there are men called Qutb, yeah, who regulate the universe. Even though Allah asked the idolaters, the disbelievers that they worship the idols, وَمَنْ يُدَبِّرُ الْأَمْرِ فَسَيَقُولُونَ اللَّهِ. And who disposes the affairs? They would say themselves, Allah. Yeah? Second thing, they believe that others have the right to be worshipped, such as supplicating to the prophets and saints for help. Like what we just discussed now. What did Allah say to them in the Quran? قُلْ إِنَّمَا أَدْعُوا رَبِّي وَلَا أُشْرِكْ بِهِ أَحَدًا. Say, O Muhammad, I invoke only my Lord, Allah alone, and I associate none as partners along with Him. So, yani Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is setting you the guidelines here. You don't need to become creative anymore. If you have any doubt or someone said this guy does this or does that, or he says this or he said that, yakhi, Allah gave you the guideline in the Quran. Khalas. If you're going to believe this person over Allah, that's a different issue. Yes? And what did Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam say? Rasul alayhi salam said, Ad-du'a'u huwa al-ibadah. Supplication is worship. Yeah? To confirm what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was saying in the Quran. Number three, to eliminate shirk altogether, is the belief that others share in Allah's attributes. This is what I shouldn't do. Such as the belief that the prophets or saints have knowledge of the unseen, al-ghayb. Allah said in the Quran, قُلْ لَا يَعْلَمُ مَنْ فِي السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ الْغَيْبِ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Say, none in the heavens and the earth knows the ghayb, the unseen, except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yeah? Fourth thing is, التَّجْبِيه. Anthropomorphism. A little bit harsh of a word here. Yeah? Basically saying, comparing Allah's attributes to humans. Such as one who says there must be a mediator between humans and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to whom you address our prayers, just as one cannot meet the ruler on, you know, a higher authority. If I want to go to a president, I cannot just meet him straight away. I have to go through the secretary and have to speak to the secretary, and the list goes on. So they try to rationalize this by saying, in order for me to go through Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there's got to be an intercessor there. You know, this is the least thing. But dawah, it failed to understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us Islam so we don't have that issue. That's the difference between us and every other religion on the planet. That we don't need that. You have a direct line 24/7, a hotline, that you can always contact Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without anyone in the middle. And what did Allah say? He said, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. Straightforward. Allah, there is nothing like unto Him. And Allah said, لَئِنْ أَشْرَكْتَ لَيَحْبِطَنَّ عَمَلُكَ وَلَتَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. If you join others in worship with Allah, then surely all your deeds will be in vain. And you will certainly be among the losers. Yeah, very simple guideline. Now, if one repents and eliminates these practices of shirk, and you worship Allah alone, tawheed, straight, he will once again become a true believer in the oneness of Allah. Yeah? And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we make us amongst the people, that they are on the right aqeedah, and that we perform the tawheed as we should. Ameen. So, now we understood what was the shirk, how should we avoid shirk, and what are the different types of shirk, yes? Now, what are the dangers and punishment of a shirk al-akbar, the major shirk? If someone is doing so and he doesn't want to repent to Allah, what are the punishments? Now, shirk al-akbar condemns one to eternal damnation in the hellfire. Allahu Akbar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, إِنَّهُ مَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةَ وَمَأْوَاهُ النَّارِ وَمَا لِلظَّالِمِينَ مِنْ أَنصَارِ. Subhanallah. Verily, whosoever sets up partners in worship with Allah, then Allah has forbidden paradise for him, and the fire will be his abode. And for the ظالمون, the polytheists and the wrongdoers, there are no helpers in the hellfire. Khalas. No one will help you. Once you're inside, assalamu alaikum. And what did the Rasul ﷺ say? مَنْ لَقِيَ اللَّهُ يُشْرِكَ بِهِ شَيْئًا دَخَلَ النَّارِ. In Muslim, who meet Allah, associating anything with him, he entered the hellfire. Straight forward, he goes to hellfire. So if a person dies on this shirk, where is he going? Hellfire. Allahu Akbar. Now, are good deeds of any benefit to one who worships others beside Allah? You have a lot of people saying, Ya Sheikh, Ya Akhi, Ya this, I'm a good person. I pay my money. I don't harm anyone. I don't kill anyone. I don't steal. I don't drink. But you know what? This peer, man, he did a lot of good things for me. I cannot just, you know, just disbelieve in him like that, man. Or, you know, this Mawlana, or this guy, or this stone. This stone was with me since I was 2 years old, and it always protected me from, you know, accidents. How can you say I cannot believe in this, yeah? So he's saying that. What did Allah say? وَلَوْ أَشْرَكُوا لَحَبِطَ عَنْهُمْ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. That's what Allah is going to say to you. But if they had joined in worship others with Allah, what's going to happen to their deeds? All that they used to do would have been of no benefit to them on the Day of Judgment. Allahu Akbar. What did the Rasul ﷺ say? أنا أغنى الشركاء عن الشرك من عمل عملا أشرك معي فيه غيري تركته وشركه. The Rasul ﷺ is speaking on behalf of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a hadith called Hadith al-Qudusi. Hadith al-Qudusi basically means this is what Allah is saying through the tongue of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yeah? He's saying, I have no need of partners. Whosoever do any deed in which they associate partners with me, I reject them and their partners as well. That's it. You cannot get more clear than this with anyone else. SubhanAllah. Now, this is major shirk. Yeah? What about minor shirk? So we have two different types. We have major and we have minor. What is minor shirk? Ash-shirk wal-asghar. Minor shirk is to worship Allah so as to be seen by others. What does that mean? Allah, what did Allah say in the Quran? فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا وَلَا يُشْرِكْ بِعِبَادَةِ رَبِّهِ أَحَدًا. So whoever hopes for the meeting with his Lord, let him work righteousness and associate none as a partner in the worship of Allah. And what did the Rasul عليه الصلاة والسلام say? He said, إِنَّ أَخْوَفَ مَا أَخَافُ عَلَيْكُمُ الشِّرْكَ الْأَصْغَرِ. And what is the shirk al-asghar? الرِّيَاءِ. What I fear most for you is shirk al-asghar. Worshipping to be seen by others. You know, mashallah. Look at this brother, man. He comes to the masjid. Thawb. Swak. Itr. Yeah, he goes, Allahu Akbar. Stands perfectly still. And he recites the Qur'an. He's doing this. You can see him, khushu'. Allah, he walks in the street. You know, Ya akhi, fear Allah. MashaAllah, proper. But the reason he's doing so is because he wants people to say, look at him, MashaAllah. He doesn't even care what Allah thinks of him. If the people see me as a good person, and I've been judged by the people that this is good, khalas, I'm okay now. This is called al-riya'. Yeah? And the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam said, لا تقول ما شاء الله وشاء فلان. وَلَكِنْ قُولُوا مَا شَاءَ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ شَاءَ فُلَانِ. Do not say, it is the will of Allah, and so, and this person or that person. But rather, say it is the will of Allah, and then because of so and so. Yeah? So if some, let's say for example, you've saved someone's life. And people say, MashaAllah, you know, Abdul Rahman saved this boy. You say, no, it's because of the will of Allah. Allah made me a reason for this boy to be alive today. You see? So you put Allah first and then you come second. Yeah? Now, is it permitted to swear by others' names beside Allah? No. What did Allah say? قُلْ بَلَى وَرَبِّيَ لَتُبْعَثُنَّ. What does that mean? Say, yes, by my Lord, you will be certainly resurrected. So in this ayah, Allah's saying, if you want to do swearing, what do you swear with? Allah. And what did the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say? مَنْ حَلَفَ بِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ فَقَدْ أَشْرَكَ. Whoever has made a swear with anyone else aside from Allah, he has committed shirk. And the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam said, مَنْ كَانَ حَالِفًا فَلْيَحْلِفْ بِاللَّهِ أَوْ لِيَصْمُتْ. Whoever must take the oath should swear by Allah or keep silent. So alhamdulillah, see, the Qur'an and Sunnah is always giving you guidelines on what to do and what not to do, and very simple. The people that say, ya akhi, you're extremist. Too much, ya akhi. The deen is in the middle path. Ya akhi, don't be so harsh. Ya akhi, no one is harsher. This is Allah and Hadith. Straight. You cannot get more clear than this. You know, this book that we're going over, mashallah, is for the kids, for the youth. Basics. Alhamdulillah. See? Very simple. So, this hadith, من كان حالفا فليحلف بالله أو ليصمت, Allah said, the Rasul عليه الصلاة والسلام, astaghfirullah, said, whoever must take the oath should swear by Allah or keep silent. And swearing by the prophets or saints is a major form of shirk. I swear by Muhammad that I'm going to do so and so. I swear by Ibrahim and Isa and Yaqub, I'm going to do so and so. This is major shirk. Why? If one believes that the saint has power to harm him, so we should refrain from taking such an oath, as this too is a major sin resulting in severe punishment. Why? Because you're swearing. When someone swears, you want to give a big credential to what you're doing, right? And that credibility, when you swear by someone, you think this is going to help you. So you believe that Allah is not the only one that can help you. Always, oh, the prophet or this saint or this person can do the same as Allah. Now, other thing, mashallah, most of the, you know, the Asian community and the African community are, you know, combined in this thing. And some of the Arabian communities, they wear good luck charms. Yeah. Especially in Turkey, when you go, you find, you know, any Turkish place, they have like this blue eye. And yeah, they put it everywhere, and like they have these blue stones, they call it al-kharz. Should we wear good luck charms? No? What did Allah say about that? وَإِن يَمْسَسْكَ اللَّهُ بِدُرٍّ فَلَا كَاشِفَ لَهُ إِلَّا هُ. And if Allah touches you with harm, none can remove it except Allah. Very simple. يا أخي, wear all the jewelry that think, and they have all the ta'weez and everything. If Allah wants you to be harmed, you're done. Hudhayfa saw a man wearing a thread around his hand, yeah, to cure the fever. So what did he do, mashallah? So he cut the thread reciting Allah's words. While he was taking it off, he said, وَمَا يُؤْمِنَ أَكْثَرُهُمْ بِاللَّهِ إِلَّا وَهُمْ مُشْرِكُونَ. And most of them believe not in Allah, except that they attribute partners with him. SubhanAllah. He was saying that while he was pulling off. Yeah. Now, this is the attitude of the true believer when he sees something that goes against what Allah teaches. Yeah, whoever sees something and he dislikes and goes against Islam, that you change it with his hands. If you cannot change it with his tongue, and if you cannot change it with his heart, and this is the weakest of iman. So, mashallah, they didn't have the weakest of iman; they had the strongest of iman. Allahu Akbar. So, should we attach beads or shells to our clothing to protect us from the evil eye? That's a different form of people thinking that it will protect them. Same. What did Allah say? Same. If Allah wanted you to be harmed, nothing is going to stop that. And the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam said in a hadith, مَنْ عَلَّقَ تَمِيمَةً فَقَدْ أَشْرَكْ. Whoever wears an amulet has committed shirk. Yani any person that you see from any community, Asian community, African community, Turkish, Albanians, whatever, and they wear something on their necks or their hands and they say, or their rings, and they say, oh no, this thing, mashallah, protects you. because the color and this and this and this. Tell him, Yahi, the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam said, whoever wears this and believes that this thing can protect him, then this is shirk. Minor shirk. Yeah. Okay? Now, intercession. Yeah? Through what might we seek intercession with Allah? What is it? What is it permissible for us to do that? The permitted and desired form of intercession is to supplicate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by His names and attributes, and by righteous deeds, and by seeking the blessings of the righteous. How can we do so? Who are the righteous people? The people that they died. La yaqi. The people that are still alive. So if I know a good sheikh, and all the people, mashallah, they say this person is a good person, yeah, he's very knowledgeable, he fears Allah, I don't go and say, you're gonna be my intercessor in the Day of Judgment. La, you ask him to do dua, for example. Ya, please make dua for me. Yeah? What did Allah say? Walillah, in the Qur'an, وَلِلَّهِ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى فَادْعُوهُ بِهَا. And Allah has the most beautiful names, so call Him with these names. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Qur'an, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَابْتَغُوا إِلَيْهِ الْوَسِيلَةِ. O you who believe, do your duty to Allah and fear Him. Seek the means of approaching to Him. So Allah's giving you guidelines. In the commentary of this ayah, Ibn Kathir, he mentioned the hadith, and he's saying regarding to the ayah, أَسْأَلُكَ بِكُلِّ إِسْمٍ هُوَ لَكْ سَمَّيْتَ بِهِ نَفْسَكَ. The dua of the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam used to do. He said, I ask you by all your names with which you call yourself. So this is give us a guideline that when you want to call upon to Allah and you want to have an intercession, you can use the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a means to that. Now, in the other hadith of the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam, in which he said, one of his companions who asked him to be with him in paradise, he said, Ya Rasulullah, I want to be with you in paradise. The Rasul salam said, A'inni ala nafsika bi kathrati sujood. Yeah? You can help me in this matter by frequent non-obligatory prayers. If you want to be with me in paradise, yeah, more prayers. Sunan, nawafil, qiyamul layl, salat al-duha. MashaAllah, eclipse is coming in a couple of days. Prayers, always. Prayers. Yeah? Now, another example for that. Follow the example of the three persons who were trapped in the cave. You know the story? What did they do? SubhanAllah. They prayed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, mentioning their righteous deeds, and Allah removed the rock as they were able to get out. As soon as they're starting, Ya Allah, the deeds, and then, what happened? Straight. Yeah? So, SubhanAllah Azza wa Jal. It is permitted to pray for intercession to Allah, mentioning our love of Him, and the love of the Messenger of the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam, and pious persons. Yeah? Since our love for them is also considered an act of good deed. What do we say in Jum'ah? Allahumma salli wa sallam ala Sayyidina Muhammad. Allahumma salli wa sallam ala Sayyidina Muhammad. We pray and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give salam to the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam. This is a mean. Yes or no? This is a mean. It's not straight to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His name and attributes. No. We ask Allah to give salam to the Rasul, so the Rasul is involved. Now, what are the forbidden forms of intercession now? To pray to the dead, asking them for provisions and help, as has been done today, mashallah. And this is, we already covered in the major shirk section, where Allah said, وَلَا تَدُعُ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ مَا لَا يَنْفَعُكَ وَلَا يَضُرُّكَ فَإِنْ فَعَلْتَ فَإِنَّكَ إِذًا مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ. And invoke not besides Allah any that neither profit you nor hurt you. But if in any case you did so, you shall certainly be one of the dhalimeen, the polytheists and the wrongdoers. As for praying by the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam's name, such as Ya Rabb Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, heal me. Yeah? This is an innovation.
So
basically, if I'm saying, Ya Rabbi Muhammad, O God of Muhammad, heal me. There's no evidence for that in the Quran or Hadith. You cannot say that. You can say Allah. No. We don't invoke anything in the dua. If the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam didn't practice it, then we don't do it. Yeah? Sayyidina Umar, when he was Khalifa, saw the prayers of Abbas, radiallahu anhu, the Prophet's uncle. He saw it. And as his closest living relative, the uncle of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he did not pray for rain, seeking the intercession of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam after death. So this is an act straightforward when Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab used to be a Khalifa. Yeah? Prayers such as this could lead to shirk. Can lead straight away to shirk. Why? Because the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam didn't do it. So if you're going to innovate something new in the deen, thinking that you can get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then it's not permissible. And Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah said, أَكْرَهُ أَنْ أَسْأَلَ اللَّهُ بَغَيْرِ اللَّهِ. I dislike supplication to Allah through anyone but Allah. Yeah? He's keeping pure when he's asking anything from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, does any supplication to Allah requires a human intermediary? What did Allah say? وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عَنِّي عِبَادِي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ. And when my slaves ask you, O Muhammad, concerning me, then answer them, I am indeed near to them by my knowledge. And the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam said, إِنَّكُمْ تَدْعُونَ سَمِيعًا قَرِيبًا وَهُوَ مَعْكُمْ. Yeah, subhanallah. In Muslim, the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam said, you pray to the one who hears and all, he hears all and he is near. And he is with you by his knowledge. Now, is it permitted to ask for the prayer of those who are living? Yes. Yeah? Why did Allah say that? Did he say it in the Quran? Yes. وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لِذَنْبِكَ وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ. Allah is saying that to the Rasul ﷺ, and ask forgiveness for your sins and also for the sins of the believing men and the believing women. And in a hadith in Tirmidhi, a blind man came to the Rasul ﷺ, and he asked, pray for me. Pray for me to Allah to heal me. Yeah? So this is a very straightforward hadith. A person went to the Rasul. He said, please, Ya Rasulullah, make dua to Allah that he healed me, as we said. So he didn't believe in the Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam being the healer, but he used him as a tool, a mean, because he's higher in grade in front of the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help him do a dua for him. But he's alive. That's the difference. You cannot ask anything from the Rasul now. Yeah, you cannot just use this hadith and saying, if he did this while he was alive, he can do that when he was dead, yes? Totally different. So yes, if I know a sheikh, a good scholar in a masjid, I can go to the sheikh and say, yeah, sheikh, you know, I have a little bit of illness in me, please make dua for me. Like the people when they do ruqya, and they go because they have a problem, they try to seek the person with the most knowledge and the most fearing to Allah, yes? You just don't go to any, you know, Tom, Dick, and Harry. True? Now, what is the mediation of the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam? This is very interesting now. The mediation of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasalam is the transmission of Allah's message. That's it. The Rasul said in the Quran, Ya ayyuha Rasul, balligh ma unzila ilayka min rabbik. O Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam, proclaim the message which has been sent down to you from your Lord. In response to the testimony of the companions in Hujjatul Wada', in the last pilgrimage of the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam, they said, Nashhadu annaka qad ballaght. We testify, we bear witness that you have transmitted the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to us. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam said, Allahumma ashhad, Allah, bear witness that I have done so by their own testimony. Yeah? Now, from whom might we seek the messenger's intercession? We may seek the messenger's intercession from Allah alone. So why? Allah said in the Quran, قُلْ لِلَّهِ الشَّفَاعَةُ جَمِيعًا. Say to Allah belongs all intercession. And the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam taught his companions to pray, اللهم شفعه في اللهم شفعه في. Yeah? Oh Allah, grant him, the Rasul, grant him intercession for me. So this is exclusively only for the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam. And what did the Rasul salam said? He said in a different hadith, إني خبأت دعوتي شفاعة لأمتي يوم القيامة فهي نائلة إن شاء الله من مات من أمتي لا يشرك بالله شيئا. You want to have the شفاعة of the Rasul عليه الصلاة والسلام? Listen to what he said. I have kept until the resurrection day my prayer for intercession, and that will be granted by Allah's grace. Yeah? For who? For those of my followers who died worshipping none but Allah. So the condition for you to have that is tawheed, oneness. Now, may we request the intercession from the living? Can we? In the deen? No. We can do that in our worldly affairs. Yeah? Allah said in the Quran, من يشفع شفاعة حسنة يكن له نصيب منها ومن يشفع شفاعة سيئة يكن له كفل منها. Whoever intercedes for a good cause will have the reward thereof, and whosoever intercedes for an evil cause will have a share of its burden. Yeah? And the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam gave us a simple guideline saying, ishfa'u tu'jaru. Intercede for others and you will be rewarded. Intercede for what? The akhirah or the dunya? The dunya. Straightforward, as the Rasul alayhi salam said. Yeah? Now, should we be excessive in our praise for the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam? Should we be excessive? Should you be excessive? As some people do, mashallah, these days. No? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, قُلْ إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ يُوحَى إِلَيْ أَنَّمَا إِلَهُكُمْ إِلَهٌ وَاحِدٌ. Say, O Muhammad, I am only a man like you. Allah, I need this as a banner in my t-shirt, especially in Bradford, yeah? I need to walk it like this, yeah? I am only a man like you. It has been inspired to me that your ilah, yeah, your God is one ilah. Very simple guideline. And the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam said in hadith in Bukhari, لا تطروني كما أطرت النصارى عيسى أطرت النصارى عيسى بن مريم فإنما أنا عبد فقولوا عبد الله ورسوله. Do not exaggerate, yeah, in praising me as the Christians do to Sayyidina Isa, to Jesus alayhi salam. I am only the servant of Allah, so say he is Allah's servant and his messenger. Yahi, the Rasul is saying that to you. Yeah? Now, going to a different topic. Yes. Bukhari. Yeah? Who was the first human creation by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Huh? Yeah, mashallah, good. He is Adam, yes. It's the first guy. Yeah, the first human person he was created by Allah is Adam alayhi salam. Allah said in the Quran, إِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي خَالِقٌ بَشَرًا مِّن طِينٍ. Yeah? Not Allah created Ali before Adam. Yeah, the Shia, they say that when Ali radiallahu anhu was there observing while Muhammad and Adam were created in the mud. Yeah, Allahu Akbar. Allah said it clear in the Quran, إِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي خَالِقٌ بَشَرًا مِّن طِينٍ. Yeah, remember when your Lord said to the angels, truly I am going to create man from clay. And the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam said, confirming this, كُلُّكُمْ بَنُوا آدَمَ وَآدَمُ خُلِقَ مِنْ تُرَابٍ. You are all the children of Adam, not the children of Ali. You are all the children of Adam, and Adam was created from dust. Hadith al-Bazar. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ أَوَّلَ مَا خَلَقَ اللَّهُ الْقَلَمُ. The first creation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created was the pen. Yeah? This is after the creation, of course, of the water and the throne and everything else. But we're saying an actual creation was the pen. And regarding the hadith, أَوَّلُ مَا خَلَقَ اللَّهُ نُورُ نَبِيُّكَ يَا جَابِرُ. The first thing Allah created you, O Jabir, was the light of your prophet. Some Sufis, mashallah, they claim, they would say, Akhi, this hadith. Yeah, Jabir ibn Abdullah saying, the first thing Allah created was the light of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This hadith is forged straight away, which contradicts the Qur'an, the Sunnah, the reasoning, and the revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yeah? As-Suyuti, one of the big scholars, they said, this hadith has no supporting chain of narration whatsoever. Al-Ghamiri said the same. It is forgery. Al-Imam al-Albani, rahimahullah, that we mentioned yesterday, said this hadith is rejected. Yeah, very simple guidelines. Inshallah, we're going to stop here today. So I don't want to overburden you. Tomorrow, inshallah, we might end. It's going to be 4 days. I was planning to finish in 4 days. And leaving the 5th day for you to revise because I'm going to give you a quiz. Whatever I said, alhamdulillah, which is good is from Allah. Whatever I say, which is bad is from myself. So forgive me for my sins. And inshallah, we're going to do tomorrow the last day. I'll try to make it the last day tomorrow, inshallah. It's the same amount. So that would give time on Friday for people to like, revise, read. I'm going to send you the PDFs, inshallah, so just give me the emails. And I think tomorrow we're going to do upstairs. And that's it. So, Jazakumullah khairan for coming today. And assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.